Thank you, Ineshka. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The American nation is founded on these and related values. The nation's founders declared these to be self-evident human rights. Self-evident meaning apparent to all and needing no proof, no justification. The founders declared these to be inalienable rights, life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness endowed by the Creator in each person, they said. Inalienable meaning part of being human, cannot be repudiated, not by a king, not by your government, not by your neighbor. America's founders recognized the importance of happiness, or rather, the importance of each person's freedom and right to pursue happiness. But 100 years later, when American schools were established, the nation's founding values didn't make it into the design. Most children's experience of school is shockingly disconnected from these values, and shockingly disconnected from their later experience as adults in society. What's this about? In school, most children don't experience fundamental American ideals of freedom, law-abiding citizenship, due process, individual enterprise, and equal voice in governance. From a child's perspective, school looks like a rigidly controlled society run by unelected dictators. Why would Americans, of all people, want to expose children to 12 years under a repressive political system that is so unlike the rest of society? How did this happen? It seems that the values of the American Revolution gave way to the values of the Industrial Revolution. And fears about immigration, too. In those days, it was fears of immigration from Europe rather than Mexico. But you can bet that if some of today's presidential candidates had been around then, they'd have been proposing to build a wall right down the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. The history of American schools is fascinating and illuminating, but that's not where we're going today. The American Revolution said governments derive their just powers from the consent of the governed. Instead of top-down governance by the king, the American democracy established bottom-up governance by the people. In that sense, democracy turned the world upside down. America established a constitution that formalized the empowerment of individuals. That was America's innovation. My colleagues and I are here today to suggest that we turn schools upside down in a similar way. Schools can be built on the constitutional bedrock of life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Schools can immerse children in the dual experience of freedom and responsibility, such as they will know as adults. I want to tell you about some basic ideas of the Circle School as an example of a democratic school. I'm going to outline some theory of education and sandwich it between a couple of slideshows. Then Brooke will add to that some perspectives on arts and ideas, Sudbury School, particularly in an urban setting. After that, Eugene, who practices opening syllabus education at the college level, will critique the notion of happiness in education. Then we're going to open the floor to discussion, your questions and comments. I can find the right window here. There we go.
This is an introduction to the Circle School.
Keep trying here. Well, it's not so much big, but let's see what that, there we go. Thank you.
Yeah, of course.
To begin, forget everything you know about school. At the Circle School, students manage their own time and pursue their own interests. What students do is limited only by the boundaries of imagination. Democratically adopted laws of the school. Different, yes, but also strikingly familiar. Think of the Circle School as a self-governing community of children, teens, and staff adults, comparable to American society, scaled down. The Circle School is based on the same principles that underlie American society and structures. The same values that are increasingly regarded as social bedrock throughout today's world. Values such as these fundamentals: personal freedom, mutual toleration, public government, and free, responsible markets. Today, our work and personal lives demand initiative, creativity, self-motivation, and self-reliance. But today's schools, designed more than a century ago, do not reflect today's world. The Circle School bridges this gap between school and life, giving students a place to practice being independent, self-responsible persons before moving to the larger world. Circle School alumni often say that they are better prepared for college and work, and their professors and employers agree. The Circle School models wholesome American values and systems. Children and teens experience rule of law, free enterprise, civil liberties, and personal responsibility. They emerge as responsible citizens, well prepared for the daily practice of life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness.
Does that look like a school you attended? That anybody here? Come on. We've got a Circle School alumna here. And I know it looks just like the school that she attended. Anybody else attend a school like this, a democratic school? Nobody else. At this point, you might have the impression that democratic schooling is about children's rights or children's liberation. In recent decades, we've seen the emergence of civil rights, women's rights, gay rights, and in a sense, you could see democratic schooling as advancing children's rights in a similar way. There's some truth in that, but I need to clarify something at this point. Democratic schooling does not promote children's rights at the expense of education. Democratic schooling does not promote happiness and democracy at the expense of education. What we find is that democratic schooling is more effective and more satisfying for students, teachers, and society. We give up nothing and we gain much. We improve quality of life for students, for teachers, and for society. We improve life satisfaction and deep happiness for students, for teachers, and for society. All right, let's talk about some theory about the circle school. But I want to talk about the purpose of schooling in general, how the circle school works in principle, and then some of our daily practices, what happens on a day-to-day basis. So what is school for? What's the purpose of schooling? You might immediately think of learning, or you might think of teaching, because some learning happens with teaching. And if there are any students in the room, then you might agree that some teaching happens without any corresponding learning. And some of the learning and teaching happens in school. But learning happens both in and out of school and with and without teaching. The point I want to make here is that learning happens anywhere, everywhere, all the time. And so to say that the purpose of school is learning or teaching certainly contains some important truth, but it's not a satisfying answer either. It leaves the question of what exactly is school for. I want you to think about that. What are the broadest aims of schooling? Why do we have school at all? And what do you want from school? So give that a moment's thought. As a student, as a teacher, as a future teacher, as a current teacher, as a school administrator, what are the broadest aims that we have in mind? If you were in charge of all schools in this country and needed to state what's your purpose, what would you think of? In fact, let's take a couple of minutes. Somebody tell me what do you suppose are the broadest aims of schooling? What do you want from schools?
To prepare you for life afterward and a job.
To prepare you for life afterward and a job. What else? Come on, you're in school. Why are you here? What's the purpose? What's the purpose of K-12 schooling? What do you want out of it? What do we want kids to acquire in elementary and secondary? Back here.
Partially, isn't it to keep kids out of the workforce so that adults can continue to work?
Aha, an economic purpose. Keep kids out of the workforce. What else?
Teach them what we think is useful for our culture and for our way of life.
Teach them
what we think is useful for our culture and way of life.
Teach them what we think is useful for our culture and way of life. Perpetuate society, sustain, maintain continuity of culture and social institutions. Yeah. Yes?
Teach them how to problem solve and transfer skills to different areas of their life.
Problem solving skills to apply to areas of their lives. What else? Purposes of school, broad aims. What do you want? You can wave a magic wand and instill whatever purposes you want. What would that be? Yeah?
To set them up for a successful future.
Set them up for a successful future. Yeah, okay. I've actually asked this question of hundreds of parents and educators and observers of schools. And most of their answers fall into two categories. Here's some of the most common answers that I've heard. Most of the answers fall into the category that I'm calling self or society. Improving the self or developing the self and engaging with society. Helping kids achieve their personal best, acquire knowledge and skills. Certain virtues and qualities, happiness and life satisfaction are important ones. These all could come under the umbrella of preparing students for future success or teaching them the things that they need to know to live in our society. The circle school buys into all of these as potential purposes of schooling. The way we say it is that school, the proper purposes of school have to do with personal fulfillment and engagement in society. American educator John Dewey said this. He said, school is not preparation for life, school is life, which is a key to understanding the circle school. So that's a little bit about purposes. Now I want to address the question of how does the circle school achieve its purposes? That is, what are the principles on which the school operates? So on the one hand, we have the self, the individual, and on the other hand, we have society, the big world beyond school. We think of the circle school as being practicing life, is the slogan we use. And that's a key to understanding the circle school. The circle school is a scaled down version of the world beyond school, and students are immersed in that world as citizens in that scaled down society. The result is kids practicing life in a scaled down version of the larger world. Now, if you take home just one idea today about the circle school, this is the one I hope you'll take home. At the circle school, students are citizens in a scaled down version of the world. That's a little bit about purpose and principle. Now I want to talk about some daily practices at the circle school, how these principles are implemented at school. The circle school is governed democratically. What that means is one person, one vote. Our school meeting, which is made of students and staff, is responsible for everything about the school. We have no principal or headmaster. The school meeting, students and staff together, are our chief executive and school head. So that body is responsible by majority vote for setting a budget, for maintaining the facilities, for hiring and firing staff, and for a whole array of other things that would come to mind. That means that a four-year-old, we have four-year-olds all the way up through high school. A four-year-old has the same right to vote that I do. A four-year-old's vote counts for exactly the same that mine does. We have three branches of government, just like the world beyond school. Legislative, judicial, and executive, and students and staff democratically perform all of those functions. We respect natural human rights, things like life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, freedoms of speech and assembly. And right out of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights from the United Nations, freedom of thought. An unusual one for school, freedom from curricular coercion. We have no required classes, no required testing, no required homework, no required grades. We practice rule of law, which means nobody can make up rules. I can't make up rules. The only way rules are made is through a democratic process, students and staff together. We have a law book with over 200 laws in it. And everyone is responsible for participating in the judicial system that enforces those laws. We practice due process, which among other things means innocent until proven guilty. So if you are charged with an infraction of a rule, and you think you're not guilty of it, you plead not guilty, and you're entitled to a trial within 4 school days. Second set of practices I want to talk about, we're calling all quadrant opportunity. That is, at the Circle School, we want students to be immersed in a world that looks like the world they're growing into. And so we want students to have experiences in mind, body, culture, and society. And in that mind quadrant, we mean all things mental, very simple. In the body quadrant, we're talking about all things physical. In the society quadrant, we're talking about social institutions, many of which have a reflection and echo in the circle school. And culture, all things that arise between and among people. Students at the circle school experience all 4 quadrants every day. You might say there's no quadrant left behind. Okay, I'm going to wrap up this segment now. We're here in a school. I've been doing some teaching. I hope you've been doing some learning about the Circle School. Specifically, I hope you've picked up some important ideas about the Circle School. We regard the proper purposes of school as having to do with personal fulfillment and engagement in society. In principle, the school operates as a scaled-down version of the world. Students are immersed in that world to practice self-directed life and community. And the Circle School features practices of freedom and responsibility and all quadrant opportunity. One more slideshow, and then we'll move on to the next segment. You're up.
Okay.
Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you. The remote? Do you want the
Sure. Which one goes? Does it just? Is it as expected?
That one
okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. How do I play it? There we go. Okay. Hi, everybody. My name is Brooke. So, how many people here are education majors, either elementary or secondary? Okay. So most of you. So I want to start. What I'm going to talk about today with my story. I was an education major as well. I graduated from the University of Delaware in 2013. And like many of you, maybe, I had always seen myself as a teacher. From when I was a young age, I knew that, that was what I wanted to do. I never had any questions about what my major was going to be. I didn't go to job fairs in high school because I knew for sure I wanted to be a teacher. I thought I was going to be kindergarten, maybe first grade, and I would have this beautiful classroom and the walls would be decorated nicely and the kids would just adore me and they would come to me 10 years later and tell me what a change I made in their lives and it would just be this beautiful experience. And then I got to college and started teaching. And it was quite different than what I expected it to be. And I started doing my student teaching placements and going, I'm not sure how it works here at Millersville, but at the University of Delaware, you go in very early on in the major and do kind of mini lessons or mini teaching. And the more I did it, the more I felt totally uncomfortable, and I wasn't enjoying it at all, and it was not what I expected. And I couldn't really put my finger on why. And I talked to some of my professors about it and talked to some other people, other people older than me in the major, and they said, oh, you get used to it, you get used to it. It's not what, you know, of course it's stressful, of course you have to deal with the paperwork and the lesson plans, but you get used to it. So I thought, all right, I'll stick it out for a little longer. But I continued to hate it more and more. I continued to feel more and more miserable in these student teaching placements. And so I sat myself down and thought, all right, why is this such a miserable thing? Why are you dragging yourself out of bed to go to these placements? Why do you hate it so much? And I really tried to step back and look at the experience without my own expectations of why I was going into the major or my own experiences with school. And I finally realized that the majority of what I was doing when I was in front of the students was managing them. And managing them down to the point of deciding when they could not go to the bathroom or eat. So I was standing in front of the class, you know, you have to give out the hall pass to go to the bathroom and you tell everyone when it's okay to go to lunch and or when it's not okay to eat a snack in the classroom and whatnot. And so I realized I'm standing in front of 25, 30 people every day and telling them whether or not they can defecate. I mean, that's absurd. That's absurd that I would be in charge of someone else's bodily functions, you know, at that basic of a level. So not even thinking about being in charge of what they're learning or the content or me telling them what's important or how to solve problems. I'm telling them when they can urinate and defecate and eat, and that we don't even trust children enough to make those decisions for themselves. And so that's where I really started to think, something is wrong here. I don't fit into this model. This doesn't make sense to me. So I thought, okay, it's not for me. It's not the job for me. I thought it was, but it's not. I actually started pursuing marine biology. That's what I thought I was going to switch my major to, of all things. And then I finally found a professor who I'm still close with today that I went and talked to, and I kind of told her about my issues and what was making me so uncomfortable and these kind of fundamental differences I was finding between myself and what school wanted me to do. And she said, go home and Google Sudbury schools. Just go and Google Sudbury schools. So I did, and I started reading about Sudbury schools, which is another name for democratic schools, like Jim spoke about and explained, like the Circle School and the one that I currently work at. And I started reading about these schools where children are trusted and respected and treated as just adults but younger and not this separate demographic of human being. And I thought, oh, duh, this is so obviously how it's supposed to work. It makes so much sense. And it just, even though I had never heard of a school like this and was coming from the same place that many of you probably are and certainly was quite different than anything I had ever experienced, it just seemed to make sense. So from there, I pursued different paths and eventually ended up student teaching at a Sudbury school in South Philadelphia. And now I currently work at Arts and Ideas Sudbury School in Baltimore, which is a democratic school very similar to the Circle School as Jim described. So I just felt like that context was relevant and that maybe some of you can relate to what I went through with that. So my focus of what I want to talk about today is, you know, this whole conference, this international policy conference, is about happiness. So I'd like to talk about how democratic schools breed happy students, and by students I just mean adults but younger, young people, and how happy young people lead to happy communities, and happy communities is the only way we can combat the turmoil that we're seeing in the United States today. So happiness, what does it actually mean? So happiness is a really broad general term, and it can refer to a lot of different emotions or states of being. Jim mentioned life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So today when I talk about that happiness, I'm not talking about life, liberty, and the pursuit of ice cream, or life, liberty, and the pursuit of a sticker on your paper. And that kind of happiness is not illegitimate, but it's not what I'm talking about, that shallow sort of just like rush of adrenaline happiness. I'm talking about, I asked myself, how do I feel when I'm happy? What's going on in my life when I would describe myself as happy? Does that work? Great. So, and I thought, when I feel happy, which I currently do in my current job, I feel fulfilled. I feel like I'm important. Like, I am important, and also what I'm doing is important, that the work that I do matters, that it matters either to myself or somebody else. I feel like I'm in control of my life. Like, I have the power to make changes in my life as needed, and that I have control over that. I feel challenged, like the problems that I'm solving and the activities that I'm completing are real and they take work to overcome. They're not easy or frivolous or silly. And I feel confident in myself. I feel brave and confident that I can overcome challenges, and I feel proud of myself when I do. So that's what I thought about when I feel happy. And then on the flip side, I thought about, you know, how do I feel when I'm unhappy? I might feel unproductive or useless, like I'm not adding anything to either my own life or the greater good. Like the things I'm doing don't matter. I might feel like I have a lack of opportunity, like the doors all around me are closed. I'm stuck in a box with nowhere to go. I'm hopeless. Feel out of control, like I'm incapable of making changes, or I'm forced to rely on, you know, a boss or a teacher or a system to make changes for me because I'm not able to or I'm not trusted to. And maybe at the end of things, I feel incompetent or stupid. I can't do it. I'm not good enough. So that's how I feel when I'm unhappy. So when I was teaching in public school before I found out about democratic schools, what I saw in the classroom was unhappiness. And this is the kind of unhappiness I'm talking about. I saw students who didn't feel productive, who didn't feel like their work mattered. And we hear it all the time. We hear students say, why do we have to learn this? This doesn't matter to me. This, you know, why do I need to know this content? It has nothing to do with my life. So this slide I like a lot. So the student says, what are taxes and how do I pay them? And school says, worry not. Mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell. This is an issue that our students are graduating without any life skills. They're graduating with content knowledge. It's not really relevant to anything unless you happen to be going into whatever content area that covers. So a story I want to share about my public school experience before I moved away from that world. When I was in a student teaching placement, I found an assignment that had been left accidentally thrown on the floor. And it was a writing assignment, not very elaborate, but a basic thing, something like, describe your summer vacation in a 3-paragraph essay or something. It was like a 5th grade classroom. I don't even really remember at this point. But the point is that I found this assignment and didn't have a name on it. So I brought it to the teacher that I was working under and said, I found this on the floor. Do you recognize the handwriting? Maybe we could find the student that it goes to. And it had a grade and a few comments on it. And she said, oh, that's from weeks ago. Just throw it away. And so I thought, looking back on that, the teacher was really saying it's going back to the work that you're doing mattering, or that's not a word, but the feeling of what you do matters. And the teacher was basically saying, it doesn't matter. They put in work into this. I gave them feedback, but it doesn't matter. Throw it away. It's not adding anything to anyone. It's useless. So I think that's really the idea that's perpetuated in traditional classrooms today, is that the work is being done is not relevant to any larger goal, and it's usually not relevant to the student, so it's useless. So when I'm at Arts and Ideas and many other democratic schools that I have visited, you can imagine what I see is happiness. So these are some photos from Arts and Ideas of some of our students just doing different things similar to Jim's video. That happiness of fulfillment, of feeling like your life matters, of feeling like you're important, that you matter to somebody else, or what you're doing matters to yourself. So, you know, I ask you, and I've asked myself and many other people this, when you think of your own childhood, what are your happiest memories? What do you think of when you imagine yourself as a child, and when were you happy? And for most people, the answer is not sitting in school or sitting in a classroom. Maybe for some people, but by far the majority of people that I talk to, their awesome childhood memories were not when they were sitting in a class learning. For most people, it's when they were hanging out with their friends, exploring, doing things that didn't have a known outcome, also known as playing, solving problems, playing challenging games. Games aren't fun unless they're challenging. And feeling like what I was doing was important. And I didn't, for me at least, and for many people that I've talked to, no one really felt like that was happening in school, or that wasn't the main area of their life where it was happening. So I wanted to share something from Dr. Peter Gray. There he is, if you want to know what he looks like. So Dr. Peter Gray is of Boston College. He's a professor of psychology there. And he writes, he has written many articles. He writes for Psychology Today. But in one of his pieces titled "School is a Prison and Damaging Our Kids," which I highly recommend, he writes, "Most students, whether A students, C students, or failing ones, have lost their zest for learning by the time they reach middle school or high school. In a recent research study, Jeremy Hunter fitted more than 800 6th through 12th graders from 33 different schools across the country with special wristwatches that provided a signal at random times of the day. Whenever the signal appeared, they were to fill out a questionnaire indicating where they were, what they were doing, and how unhappy or happy they were at that moment. The lowest levels of happiness by far occurred when they were in school. And the highest levels occurred when they were out of school playing or talking with friends. In school, they were often bored, anxious, or both. Other researchers have shown that with each successive grade, students develop increasingly negative attitudes towards the subjects taught, especially math and science." So this is not just anecdotal evidence. They've gone and researched this kind of thing, and it's pretty clear that students are not happy in school, that kids don't feel happy in school. And again, that happiness meaning fulfilled, important, useful. So what happens if we switch this whole paradigm shift, if we shift our paradigm of why, like what Jim spoke about, why we have schools, what's the purpose of education, and what if we ask the question, what happens when we start to raise happy students? What's the outcome? What are the possibilities if we raise students that are happy, that feel like their life matters, and that they don't have to wait until they're 18 to start their life? So I'm going to go back to my school, Arts and Ideas Sudbury School. Many democratic schools are in more rural areas, and there's more and more are starting to open in urban neighborhoods, and Arts and Ideas is one of them. So the community at Arts and Ideas, we have 52 students as of today and 4 staff members. We're an extremely diverse community. We've got tall kids, short kids, black kids, white kids, fat kids, skinny kids, gay kids, straight kids, who knows what kids, all different colored hair. We've got one-parent families, two-parent, three-parent, 4 grandparent families. I mean, we really run the spectrum. Kids of lawyers to kids living out of cars. We've got kind of the whole gamut of life at our school, more or less. We're also cheap. The average Baltimore City private school tuition is around $25,000 to $30,000 a year. Arts and Ideas charges $6,125 a year. Which our unofficial motto is we're cheaper than daycare. So we have to charge tuition because we don't get any federal funding or state funding. So we have to take a little bit of salary so we can eat, and we have to keep our lights on. So we do have to charge a little bit of tuition. But in general, absolutely, our policy is that if a child wants to be at the school and the family understands the model of education, we will do what needs to happen to make that family able to come to our school. So we're different from other private schools in that sense. Many other private schools don't share that ethos that we do. And the biggest thing that I want to talk about is, dun-dun-dun, Arts and Ideas is in Baltimore. So Baltimore, there's more than murder here. Baltimore, before I get into this, I just want to say Baltimore is an awesome city. I love living in Baltimore. It is a beautiful, vibrant, creative, diverse community, and I truly love my city. However, many of you have probably heard about Baltimore in the news lately, about the Freddie Gray riots, about the turmoil, the race relations in Baltimore, everything that's going on, these deep-rooted issues in our neighborhoods and our communities in Baltimore. So I'm not going to go into the whole history of the events of what's happened with everything surrounding Freddie Gray's death and upcoming trial and all of these things. But the basic story is things are rough in Baltimore. They've been rough. They continue to be rough. We're not there yet by any stretch. So leaders in Baltimore, and when I say leaders, I mean political leaders, but also well-known bloggers in our community, community activists, people who run community centers, et cetera, people who have a big name in our community, they're all asking for similar things. They're giving out these calls to action. They're saying neighborhoods need to work together. We need peace. We need cohesiveness. We need to make changes. We need to not just talk. We need to make action. They're all calling for similar things in our neighborhoods, regardless of where they're coming from. And the things that they're calling for remind me a lot of the language that came to me when I thought about what makes me happy. When they're saying we want communities that are respectful, useful, have purpose, you know, are important, are taking care of themselves, you know, all these things are very similar to that, to going back to that happiness. And yet, during the riots, they closed the schools. They closed Baltimore City schools. They didn't let kids go to school. They enforced a curfew. They kept people, but especially children, isolated. They didn't allow for that conversation. They said, stay at home, keep the kids away, locked away, don't let them out, don't let the hooligans out. So my question is, why don't we want children to be active members in our neighborhoods, in our community, in our conversations? It goes back to this idea of children just being adults but younger. You never stop becoming. So children are just on the same age spectrum as we all are. They're just at the on one end of it. They're not a separate demographic than adults. And yet we lock them away and we're scared of them. And truly, we view children as criminals. And Jim said a bit about this, about the idea of innocent before proven guilty at Sudbury schools or Democratic schools. But we, in general society, and certainly in Baltimore City, I truly see that people see children as a body to be feared, that we should be afraid of children. And schools absolutely treat children as guilty before proven innocent instead of the other way around. Many school physical layouts are modeled after prisons. I can't think of anywhere else in the world where, or in, at least in the United States, where people are forced to stay in the same room all day with someone telling, you know, being in charge of you going to the bathroom, of not being able to leave the room without either supervision or a specific pass to leave the room. The only other place that that happens is prison. Where people are that confined and forced to be there. You know, a job might be awful. You might have a horrible dictatorship or dictator-like boss, but you can still quit. You can't quit jail and you can't quit school, no matter how much you might want to for either one of those. So we really view children as criminals. A good example is that, and I'll get more into this, but Arts and Ideas, where I work, has an open campus policy. So children of all ages are allowed to leave school during the day and go out into the neighborhood and go on walks, go to stores, et cetera. And most of our community of those local stores and shops love this, but we have one kind of our enemy in our neighborhood is 7-Eleven. Boycott 7-Eleven. So 7-Eleven has a policy that we found out that they don't allow children in during the day without supervision. And they say during the day, but I can't imagine they would let them in at night either. And this, we found out about this because two of our students went to 7-Eleven to buy some candy. These were two 10-year-old girls. They went over there with a couple dollars. 7-Eleven is right down the street from us. And they went to go buy some candy and they were kicked out. They were told they had to leave. So we went over, I went over with some of the other staff members just to ask them about this, to say, what's your policy? We thought maybe we could tell them about our school, explain that it's fine for our kids to be off campus and maybe work out a relationship. And they told us that the policy is very strict. They're not going to change it. And that the reason that they have this policy is because one time they saw kids on camera stealing, not kids from our school, but just kids at some point in history on camera stealing. And so now they don't allow kids in their store just in case, because they had seen children stealing before. Now to me, that's the exact same thing as saying, we saw black people on our camera stealing one time, so we don't let black people in our store unless they come in with a police officer. I don't see too much difference in those two situations. It's segregating against an entire group of people because of one aspect, race or age. But either one, we're saying we're assuming that children are criminals because one time a child was a criminal. And I don't see much difference between that and we're assuming all black people are criminals because one time a black person was a criminal. And I don't agree with either of those statements, just to be clear. So children, just like adults, again, live up to our expectations. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. When we treat children like criminals, if we tell children you can't, you're not able to, you can't be independent, you can't decide when you need to pee, you're not able to do those things, you can't decide what you want to learn, you're not able to do that, then they think of themselves as unable to do that, and they become incompetent and incapable. And if we make kids feel like they aren't smart or capable enough to have control over their own lives, they will feel stupid, incapable, and incompetent, and their actions will result from these feelings. So, you know, let's think about the idea that humans are naturally curious, sensitive, empathetic, adaptable, and confident creatures. I mean, think of a toddler. Have you ever known a lazy toddler? I never have, or a toddler that's not curious. Never. I mean, toddlers are bursting with just wanting to touch and feel and explore everything. And so I'd like to make the case that that doesn't have to go away, that we don't have to squash that. And we hear this in interviews at our school, and we have families coming in with kids that want to transfer to our school. We hear it all the time. It's almost verbatim in interviews that my child is bright, capable, curious, and then they started going to school and their spirit has been crushed. We feel like we're losing them. They're telling us to medicate our child, or they're telling us our child is incompetent. But I know my child, they're smart and funny and brave, and yet this, they're getting a totally different message at school, and slowly over time they're getting crushed by that system if they aren't able to kind of play the game. We hear this over and over again. So what if instead of treating children like criminals, we give them space, trust, and respect through democratic schooling? You know, we'll replace those unhappy qualities with those happy ones, with children who feel like their lives matter. Let's see, what is my next one? So I want to go back to our off-campus policy at Arts and Ideas. So these are some pictures of our kids off campus, just kind of out in the world doing things, buying things. And this idea that of how we view children and how we view children as something to be feared, and that they're criminals. And instead, we see our neighborhood in Baltimore embracing our kids, besides 7-Eleven, the rest of the community embracing our kids. And they see students coming into their stores that are polite. They look the adults in the eyes. They know how to spend money. They know how to ask questions. They are exceptionally patient. And so we hope that we're spreading this idea out into the community, that children are not something to be feared, or little criminals that we have to be looking out for and need to be supervised because, you know, otherwise they'll just create chaos, but that instead they're just people but younger. And we find that our off-campus policy, and even on campus where students are largely unsupervised during the day, unless they just happen to be hanging out with staff or staff happen to be in whatever activity they're doing, that we have an exceptionally safe environment. And I mean that in many different senses. Emotionally safe, the instances of bullying and harassment in our school is extremely low, if not completely non-existent. And then also physical safety. In the 8 years that Arts and Ideas has been open, we've had 2 broken bones. One was right in front of a staff member when a girl fell off a swing and broke her elbow, and there was a staff 5 feet away from her. And the other was last year when a teenager slipped on a wet spot in the bathroom and fractured his leg. So I don't think either of those situations would have been helped by supervision, again, with that police presence analogy of having to go in a store with a police officer versus an adult. It doesn't make any sense. So I think when schools feel safe, children feel safe, they feel like their neighborhoods are safe, that's what leads to these productive, cohesive, respectful, useful communities that Baltimore leaders are calling for. And that's a happy community. The point is that those communities are happy, and by happy I mean useful, fulfilled, productive. And when we have students that are being raised as respecting themselves, they will respect their community, and they'll be active members and help make changes and make these changes that Baltimore City leaders are calling for. And we need schools that allow this kind of happiness to flourish. And my final point is to not force kids to wait. So right now, we tell kids, just when you're 18, then you get to start your life. Then you graduate, then you get to choose your major and go to college and choose your job. So you have to sit through school for 12 years, and then you get to start your life. So having to wait to feel that sense of importance and competence, it's not only unproductive and inefficient because we've got this huge body of capable people that are being told, no, wait, when they could be making great changes in our community and helping combat issues of racism and violence, and this huge demographic of smart, awesome people that are being told, no, stay home, don't go to school when the riots are happening, don't talk to anybody, stay secluded, we can't use you. So it's not only incredibly unproductive and inefficient, further than that, it's harmful. I think it's hurting students to put them through 12 years of course of curriculum and schooling, aka prison in many ways, because those feelings of incompetence and uselessness, they plant their seed, that seed gets planted early. And again, we hear this at our school, and we have first graders, second graders coming to our school, and the parents saying, my child has lost their spark. That seed plants early, and it is hard to eradicate. I am still working on telling myself that I'm not, the whole idea of I'm not a math person. There's no basis behind that of people being a math or a reading person. That's not a real thing. And yet so many of us have that label of ourselves. Oh, I'm just not that kind of person. I'm not set out for that kind of reading. I'm not capable. I'm not good enough. And that comes, I think, largely from school. And those seeds plant themselves early, and they're hard to eradicate and overcome that. And we see that when we see students in college. We see many students get to college and feel completely lost. They feel, you know, like they're completely out of control. They don't have life skills. I mean, it's funny, but how often do we hear the story of, oh, I got to college and my roommate had never done laundry before, or doesn't know how to fill up gas in a car, and those, you know, those basic life skills they don't even have yet when they turn 18. And we see that as a result of how we treat children in K through 12 schools. So my final question is, if we decide to replace this fear of children with trust and respect, what's the worst thing that could happen? Is it that kids could be happy? That's it, I'm done now.
Good afternoon. My name is Eugene Matusov. I'm a professor at the University of Delaware, where Brooke attended. And I teach teachers, future teachers. Also, I teach future educational researchers. And my role here will be a little bit strange. I will be a spoilsport. I'm actually will be challenging ideas that education should be about for pursuing happiness. That's, I see, my role here. So kind of spoiling whole conference, I guess, here. I will want to start, basically I will present four arguments against idea that education should be for pursuit of happiness. And I start with the agreement and about, with agreement with critique of the schooling a little bit. And my understanding, actually, I'll turn around, majority of you, if maybe not all of you, are teach also education students or future teachers. Is it right? Okay, I can see a lot of people saying that. And so you like not very different from my students. And sometimes I, at the beginning of my classes, I do this interesting experiment. I could have done it with you as well. Just we don't have enough time to do that. I usually do this index cards, small index cards. And I ask the students, I ask them, don't put your name there. It's not important about your name. But write, or you can draw a picture if you want, a response to the following statement. And the statement is very simple. Class is canceled. Okay? I didn't say which class. Just class canceled. Okay, and then people can write in one word or two words and make pictures there, and then we collect them, and then we were reading these cards, and I usually put three faces, like smiling face, like neutral face, and like gloomy face. Upset face. Can you predict what the result of this kind of survey? The majority, in some classes only, it will be only smiling face. Yes! And there is many interesting comments from, yes, I can sleep, I can do these things, and so on and so forth. You can think about what you would write there on the index cards. There are some neutral faces, very rare happened, and very, very rare happened some kind of upset faces. By the way, on the close investigation, we find that the students attend, those who put this, say something negative about that, the class is canceled, they usually have very non-traditional schooling experiences. And then, for me, it became very interesting paradox, which I share with my students. I can share it with you. Because I said, sounds like a little strange. You hate school and want to be teachers. So, doesn't mean that you're guys, sadist? You enjoy torturing other people? Like you suffered yourself, now you prepare to suffer, to torture other people. And when I share that, my students immediately protest. That's very common protest. They say, no, it's not about that. It's not about that. It's just like we will have some other things to do. Okay, we're just happy because we have something to do. Okay, I said, okay, let's test this idea. Imagine that you're going to the movie with your friends, and suddenly you see the movie is canceled, and you say, yes, I can go to sleep, I can go to something else to do. No, no. There is something rotten in this, in schools. And people feel one way or another, and this is what reflects them, because they just don't like to be there, okay? So, and the question becomes, like, do you want to be a teacher when you get sick, your students will be so happy because the class is canceled? And I was constantly, like, looking for the school when the students will be unhappy when the school or class is canceled. I actually found that school. I went to a gym school, and I talked with the kids and asked them the same question. Would you be happy if the school will be canceled? Like, I don't know, Sarah is here.
No, so, I remember being very upset.
Uh-huh. And I thought, yes, this is what type of education I really like to have. You know, I haven't visited a school with the Brookies, that's on my agenda, okay? But yes, but I suspect that it's very different type of school, and probably kids will be also unhappy, right? But which is very different from my experience and maybe your experience. So the question is, so is it that school possible or not possible, and why we don't have schools like that? And can schools like Jim and what Brooke was talking about, can be they scaled up? And again, remember, I spoil sport. My answer is no. But that's another interesting story. Let me start, do you know that the word school, it's not English word, it's not Russian word. I'm actually Russian, you can hear my accent, like I'm Russian. That's not, unfortunately, Russian word. Do you know what's this language and come from, the word school? German? No, it's not. Although it sounds like a little bit German, school. No, but it's not German. Anybody knows that school one? It's a Greek word. It's not German, but Greek. Do you know what it means in Greek? Even now, it means in Greek. It's interesting to be a Greek person, because you'll be shocked right now to hear what the word school means. Just, are you ready? Just brief little bit, just prepare to be shocked. The word school means leisure. Can you imagine? The last thing you think about school is leisure. Leisure. Something that you do in free time. What's that? Well, if you look at the kind of Greek situation, Back then, people had a lot of time because they had slaves. And by people, mostly it's male men. And they have women who's doing home stuff with the slaves. But schools was not actually focused so much on children, but for adults. And what they were doing this as a specific type of leisure. And basically it was used for people to think, to investigate things about the life, the self, the society, the world, the cosmos, the politics, and so on and so forth. That was the goal of the school as leisure that Greeks invented. And somehow, when it came to us, it got completely distorted for some strange reasons. Which is interesting to think about what these reasons, why we have this school that nothing to do with the original school that Greeks invented. But now let me turn and I will talk about that. Like why I think school is not about pursuit of happiness. Because think about that, the Greeks would disagree with this idea that the school is about pursuit of happiness. Because it's about investigation of life, including investigation happiness as well, but it's critical investigation. It's not necessarily how to make everybody happy or how themselves become happy. It could be, but could be not. One of the reasons why I'm kind of against the idea of education for happiness is that's one idea. It's not like, think about that. It means we educators think about what should be purpose of education. Why is it should be our goal to decide that? It should be purpose, it should be a business of our students to decide what's their education is about, rather than someone decides that. And the point is that we in our society, we think that education is a social, societal business. While actually, if you think about it, education happens with person. It's about how changes views on certain things, learning something new. It's a personal business. It's not societal business, education. Even more, if you think about that, education, we actually look in some slides. Education usually think about like it's for the jobs. So education serves to something. It's for the competitions. It's for the jobs. It's for the becoming citizenship. It's learning about citizenship. It's about moving up social mobility and so on and so forth. So the in each of these answers, or it could be about babysitting of the kids and getting out of the jobs, or it could be about teaching patriotism, or and so on and so forth, teaching nationalism. In each of these answers, what's common is that education is instrumental. It's used for something else. While education may be, and we should at some consider education for the sake of education. Education has its own internal practice, internal sphere. Let me give example, like many other things, like art. Why people engage in art? Well, some crazy educators saying, you know why we need to teach art? Because it's increased math test scores. How many of you are engaged listening to music, going to see movies, engage in some like paintings, just in order to increase your math test scores or math even knowledge? My suspicion is zero. Maybe there are some people, I don't know them, but in my view it's zero. People engage in arts for the sake of arts, not for the sake of employment. Well, some maybe do that for the sake of employment, that's true. But the majority of people engage in arts for the sake of art. Why? Because without arts, for many people, they feel that their life is not fulfilled. The same thing is about education. Education should have its own sphere. Just we all engage in education, not in school, but through whole our life. We might not recognize that, but it could be as well. Why? Because we are curious. We're interested about life, self. We're constantly learning about that. We're constantly learning about society. And it happens not only in school. And we're doing that not in order to become better workers, better this, better that, although it could be true as well. But for the, it's just a part of our human life to learn something new, something interesting, critically look at that. Okay? So this is another reason why I think education for happiness as education for and dot, dot, dot is wrong. Okay, because education should be open for anything, including education that investigates happiness. Not education for the sake of achieving happiness, but education investigating happiness, like many, like investigating unhappiness as well. It's like investigating anything else. Another reason why I don't like education for happiness is, you know what? I think another reason why education should not be decided by somebody else, but only by students, because the goal, deciding what's goal of education should be part of education itself. It's not like the teachers or society or politicians should decide education should be for that. No, I think students should be engaged in deciding what's their education about, what's good education. In general, what's good education for them as well. And this is another reason why I don't like education for happiness. Yeah? Well, to be brief, my last kind of point, I know that in the United States Constitution, there is a point about pursuit of happiness. And I'm nothing against having people have right to pursue happiness. But I have problem with that personally. I don't like to pursue happiness. Why? Because I think the more I will try to pursue the happiness, the more unhappy I will become. And I'll tell you why. It's like the same thing. If you experience sometimes being insomnia, you couldn't sleep. The more you will focus on how the fact that you, the pursuing sleepiness, the more awake you will become. The best strategies, if you know about that, right, counting sheep or so and so forth, it's actually stop having any anxiety. Stop even thinking about much about your sleepiness problem, insomnia. Okay? Happiness, in my view, it's a byproduct of our life. We cannot focus on that. We cannot pursue that. It's not like a goal to pursue. There are some achievable goals, for example, like we can have a goal of climate change, and that's a very good goal. But the happiness, sleepiness, love, and by the way, learning is not a good goals to pursue. They are byproduct of something else. If you're doing good life, you might have experienced sometime happiness and sometime maybe unhappiness as well. And that's also interesting things, how happiness might require some kind of unhappiness as well. But that's another story. So this is another reason why I think education for happiness, for pursuing happiness, may be not a good idea. Okay, well, I hope I will disturb enough to be a spoil sport and make you guys unhappy. Thank you.